Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Can I crave a moment of your attention, please? My name is Babalal Sethia. I'm the president of the Royal Society of Medicine, and it's my special privilege to welcome you all here tonight. Many of you may be familiar with us because this is the fourth year in which we've had the privilege of hosting the Royal African Society to give a lecture here at the RSM. We are an educational charity, and funnily enough, for the last 4 years, we've been also developing a big program in global health, and most recently been engaged in helping the education for the UK response to Ebola. But tonight, it's a great privilege to welcome Dr. Obi Ezekwesili, and I'm not going to say anything much more. I'm going to hand over to the chair of the Royal African Society, Zainab Badawi, who will be well known to many of you here. And we here at the RSM look forward to an exciting and engaging talk. So Zainab, all over to you.
Thank you very much indeed, B. Sethia, for hosting us at our annual lecture. It is my great pleasure. Good evening, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, friends, fellow Africans. But tonight, everybody's African, actually. So thank you very much indeed for coming to this evening. It is my first annual lecture as chair of the Royal African Society. So it's really a great, great occasion and privilege for me, especially since I see so many good friends and hopefully new ones in the audience. And most of all, because my first annual lecture is being delivered by somebody who I have admired first from afar and then have had the privilege of admiring her from much closer in the last few years, and Obi is a dear sister to me. So what we are going to have today is a half-hour lecture that Obi is going to give, and then after that there'll be an opportunity for questions and answers from you in the audience, or even just brief comments. So I just say in advance, it would be nice if everybody could keep their comments as brief as possible in order to make sure that everybody can participate. Obi, as you know, is a great public servant, not only in her own Nigeria, but also across the continent of Africa and also across the world. She earned the nickname Madame Due Process because of her great... You don't mind that nickname, do you? I could think of worse ones to be called. So that's not bad. And that was because of her commitment to transparency, to making sure that everything is being done right. And that's why she was given that nickname. And of course, recently, as most of you will know, she hit the headlines very much with her Bring Back Our Girls campaign, when sadly nearly 300 girls were abducted in Chibok earlier this year. And Obi, on that, we salute your efforts, and we also are with you, and we all hope and pray that these girls will be return to their families as soon as possible. Now, I'll tell you a bit about Obi and what she has done throughout her career so far, and is still obviously going to achieve great things. And she's unusual because she has served in so many sectors of public life as a politician, in the executive, also as an academic, in NGOs, in international NGOs, in civil society. So she's really seen things from all corners of the prism. And that's what really makes her quite unique, because she brings many perspectives to, you know, whatever topic she's engaged with, but always with great... commitment and also with humour, which is very important. So Obi is currently a senior economic advisor at the Open Society Foundations, and that, of course, is a group that was founded by George Soros. She also jointly serves as a senior economic advisor for the Africa Economic Development Policy Initiative. My God, what a mouthful. And that's a programme of the Open Society Foundations. And in these roles, she actually advises 9 African heads of state, including people like Paul Kagame Army of Rwanda and Ellen Johnson Sirleaf of Liberia. And of course, frankly, of course, African leaders need a great deal of advice, don't they, Obi? And wonderful that you are providing that for them. And before joining OSF, she was vice president of the World Bank in Washington, and she was responsible for operations in 48 countries. So she's got that really, you know, wide, extensive experience of Africa. And she was controlling a lending portfolio of nearly $40 billion. I hope every penny was accounted for. And Before that, between 2002 and 2007, Obi worked for the federal government of Nigeria as Minister of Education, Minister of Solid Minerals, and head of the Budget Monitoring and Price Intelligence Unit, as well as chairperson of the Nigeria Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative, where she led the first ever national implementation of the global standards and principles of transparency in the oil, gas, and mining sectors. And she was a key member of the team of President Obasanjo. And she was also at the Center for International Development at Harvard University as director of the Harvard Nigeria Economic Strategy Program, working with people like Professor Jeffrey Sachs. She's a chartered accountant by profession and holds an MA in international law and diplomacy from the University of Lagos, as well as an MA in public policy and administration from the Kennedy School of Government, Harvard University, of course. She trained as a chartered accountant consultant with Akintola Williams, Deloitte and Touche, and worked in senior management positions. And of course, she was a founding director of Transparency International, representing Africa at the Global Anti-Corruption Body based in Berlin. I'm exhausted, Obi, just listening, reading all this out. I don't know how you found the time to do this, and you're still only 25. And she serves on the board of Bharti Airtel, World Wildlife Fund, the School of Public Policy of Central European University of Budapest, the Center for Global Leadership at Tufts University, Boston, and the New African Magazine, so many things. And in 2012, she was honored by her own country with an honorary Doctor of Science degree by the University of Agriculture, Abeokuta in Nigeria. And she's also been awarded the Nigeria National Honor of the Commander of the Order of the Federate Republic. So a great, great lady, a great servant of Africa and its people. And Obi is going to be talking tonight about Africa Rising, to see what will happen when her citizens arise. Obi, my dear, please come and take the floor.
Good evening. What a delight to be able to join you all at this very important event on Africa. The Royal Africa Society is indeed a repository for everything African. From the many years of its focus on being a place where you could find academic work on Africa to recent times when it has caught the bug and the infection of global integration of the ideals of what it takes to really have a society where all sectors come together, and so that the academia can no longer stay in its insularity and just completely ignore every other aspect of the human life as though that belongs to people who were somehow inferior to the academics. And so today, the Royal African Society in all that it does, whether it's with the arts or what it does with every other activity that seemingly doesn't or didn't used to qualify to be called intellectual, has in many ways opened up the gate for the real sense of village. And village is a concept that's important for us as people from the continent of Africa. So I am glad to be a member of this village tonight. My dear friend and my dear sister, Zainab, I have to say that I was going to say to Richard, it's impossible to get this on my schedule until I got an email from Zainab that said, Obi. At that point, I knew I wasn't going to escape. So I am so glad you're the chair of this very prestigious body. And I know that you're going to bring so much energy. You know that about Zainab, don't you? You're going to bring so much energy to the kind of profoundness that this association this society requires as it grows along with Africa. Richard, thank you so much. You've been a dear friend for so many years now, decades actually. And, I was very glad you were not there when The Economist did what they did. Because I knew that there was no way Richard would have been there and that caption would have come out. I am so excited to see my mentor, Shirley Williams. How did you get yourself here, old lady? Shirley, you know, you meet some people in life and something changes. I met Shirley when I went to do an executive program at the Kennedy School. And at that time, I was almost starting off a PhD program at the King's College at the University of London on international law. And she looks at me after one of the classes and she said, "International law, that's not what the continent needs. You need public policy, girl." And that changed my whole plan in life. Shirley, you know how much I love you. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you. When I was asked what topic I would be speaking on, I said to Richard, I want to talk about Africa rising. Wait and see what happens when her citizens arise. I thank you for the opportunity of giving this year's lecture. My sincere hope is that the conversations on Africa will continue to be much more profound than they used to be in time past. Africa was written off as a hopeless continent 13 years ago by The Economist. Since after that, Africa has managed to confound the skeptics, becoming the world's fastest growing region with an annual GDP growth on the continent averaging some 4.8% over the past decade, 2002 to 2011. In fact, the growth on the continent was initially assumed to be very superficial. And so when the global economic crisis came, many predicted that that was goodbye to the so-called African growth. And I recall that at that time, I was still at the World Bank. And one thing that I was very certain about was that if Africa managed to stay true to the conditions that led to the growth in the first place, it would be able to buck the trend of collapse in growth across the rest of the world. And Africa did go down in growth. Growth dipped to about 1.9% between the period of 2009 and 2010. But by 2011, growth resumed and went up back to above 3%, and subsequently has held strong at nearly 5%. Now, why has this been important for the continent? It's been important because before this decade of cheerful data of growth, the continent used to grow at less than 3%, or at most 3%. And that growth rate was equal to the growth rate in population. And so clearly, there was not real substance in terms of the impact of growth. When, however, Africa held steady on growth, it became clear that there was much more that needed to be understood about the new narrative. One of the things that I discovered upon going to the World Bank was that it was often tough for people to say anything positive about Africa, lest they be proven wrong. And so because of the risk averseness of people concerning any positive story about Africa, it had less number of voices that dared to even say anything of the good things that were happening on the continent. And so by the time I got to the World Bank, I decided that it was important to focus on empirical evidence as a basis for counteracting the possibility of being laughed at when anything good was spoken about Africa. And so it was necessary to find all the data, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And if anybody had legitimacy to be able to speak about the bad and the ugly, an African woman had all of it. And so we got all the data, and the data proved clearly that certain things had fundamentally changed on the continent. Some of the things that had changed on the continent and were driving the growth that we saw happening at that time was one. Africa had become well attuned to the necessity for prudent macroeconomic management. Before then, it was hard for the continent because it simply did not manage its macroeconomics well. The universality of the application of the rules of economic fundamentals was not going to be sparing of any continent, even if it was a continent that needed support. Economics don't work on the basis of what would be good to happen. They simply work on the basis of what is proper that should happen. And so the more that African countries began to pursue basic rules of macroeconomic stabilization and focused on achieving fiscal and monetary policies that were salient to macroeconomic stability, they had better macroeconomic fundamentals. And the better macroeconomic fundamentals supported the growth process. And so growth, first and foremost, is attributable to better housekeeping of the finances and the public finance on the continent and better monetary policies. So over the period, what we saw were rapidly declining rates of inflation. We saw lower budget deficits. We saw less volatility in the exchange rates. And we saw very clear improvements in the way that the management of the public finance, in ensuring that Africans were no longer spending money that they did not have. Many of the countries had run themselves into the debt albatross as a result of poor housekeeping of their finances. One of the things that we also saw in interrogating the basis of the growth that was happening on the continent at that time was that Africa began a process of competitiveness amongst the countries. In a sense, by looking across the border and seeing that a country to the left or to the north or to the east of your own country got praised for doing something right, leaders felt they needed that praise themselves. And so at the World Bank, we have this famous product, research product of at that time, and it still exists, the World Bank Doing Business Indicators. And by merely looking at the basics of what a business environment in any of the countries looked like, comparing them across the world, some countries that were very determined to do well actually did well and would show up on the global league table on business improvements in environment as part of the top reforming countries. And I do recall what used to happen. I would get a call from an African president and who would say to me, "Why did my neighbor do better than I did?" And I would say to them, they did better because they worked harder. And I would say to them, "Do you want to do better than your neighbor during the next annual report?" And they would say yes. And that would be my license for identifying the toughest set of reforms that would be necessary to shift the outcomes in furtherance of economic progress for the countries. And so that competition amongst the leaders in terms of where their countries showed up on global economic league table for a simple matter as the environment for doing business made a lot of difference in the kind of policy choices that we began to see. Why was that important? That was important because in many ways it supported the rapid liberalization and deregulation of a sector that subsequently provided Africa the basis for it being called a continent that has its own revolution. The telecom revolution that happened on the continent did not just happen. It happened because important regulatory policies, important institutional policies, important sectoral policies were undertaken by different countries on the continent. Without those reforms, it would have been impossible for the private sector to have seen the incentive to enter into a sector that was for many decades the most inefficient of sectors on the continent. As a matter of fact, at that time, before the reforms of the telecom sector, there were just about 20 million telephone lines in the entire continent of Africa. Following the reforms of the telecom sector in Africa, today we're probably closer to 500 million telephone lines on the continent. That's a revolution. Africa has its own revolution. It didn't just happen. It happened because there was work that needed to be done, and that work was done. Another thing that I'd like to talk about for that period was also a lot of people associated the period to be a period of global commodity boom. And so many times people said that Africa's growth was superficial because it was driven purely by the rising commodity prices. And being one who is not persuaded by suppositions, I would ask our team to investigate and interrogate the composition of Africa's growth. And research would show that just about one-third of that growth was being contributed by rising commodity prices at that time. Just one-third. The rest of it was coming as a result of the improved macroeconomic environment, and of course, some of the nascent sectoral improvements, like what I just spoke about concerning the telecom sector and such other sectors. Well, there is no doubt that coming from a low base of growth, that everyone would be excited that Africa has indeed achieved a sustained growth level today of an average of a little less than 5%, and that the forecast for it is on the upward, according to the IMF. Before the next 3 years, Africa should be able to grow at an average of above 6% annually. That would be good growth. However, for a continent which still has 48% of the citizens in the poverty bracket, of those surviving on $2 a day, it is not yet time to be triumphalist about Africa rising. Africa rising will be worth celebrating when the 48% that are excluded from the benefits of the growth of the last decade are ultimately part of the process of Africa's growth and its development. Mere economic growth has proven to not be sufficient. Economic growth must translate to improvement in the quality and the standard of living of citizens in order for it to be worthy of absolute celebration. Mere economic growth is not enough, because what we have seen of Africa's growth is that as it grew and left many behind, inequality deepened in many of the societies where the growth has been most accentuated. When you're dealing with the twin problem of poverty and inequality, you create a very implosive seed that would need to be immediately tackled for a continent with fragile context of governance. Ladies and gentlemen, if anyone talks about Africa's growth without talking about the paradox of that growth, that person is unfair to Africans. As an African, I celebrate the better trajectory that our continent has had in the last decade and a half. However, I agree with Mukisa Kituyi, the head of UNCTAD, when he said, economic growth that does not create decent jobs in sufficient quantities is unsustainable. Economic growth may have changed the way that Africa is perceived and proven that the continent can indeed grow, because sadly, some people were beginning to be very offensive in the way they analyzed the lack of growth by Africa at some point in time. However, when we think of the fact that majority of the countries in Africa went off track in the attainment of the Millennium Development Goals, and the 2015 is here with us. When we think of the fact that there are vulnerable contexts within which a lot of the countries are today growing, the external shocks of declining commodities prices is here again. And unfortunately, for key countries, including mine, they simply did not completely learn the lessons of previous boom and bust conditions. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, looking at the disconnect between growth and poverty reduction and equity in the distribution of the benefits of growth, one is led to the most important issue that one believes would need to be confronted. And that issue is the absence of African citizens in the choices made concerning their development. Everything about Africa's growth that I spoke about, the improvement in macroeconomic management, the improvement in some of the policy choices that led to growth. Incidentally, happened at a time where external pressure that was necessary for the reduction of Africa's debt was being applied on the continent. And so if Africa wanted debt reduction, it needed to run macroeconomic stability as an important condition. It needed to undertake certain key reforms. And a lot of those requirements were externally determined. It helped in many ways. But what we now know is that externals cannot give development to any continent or to any country or to any people. The ownership of the development process by the African citizens has been the missing link for the kind of development that benefits more people than currently benefit from mere economic growth. African citizens are no different from many citizens of the world today who absolutely don't care about the sometimes very unimpressive politics that goes on in their countries. Apologies to my dear Shirley Williams. But many citizens of countries have completely disconnected themselves from their ruling elite. Citizens are simply fed up with the way that politics is arranged and how it is concentrated amongst a very small grouping of global elite who all have each other's telephone numbers. Yeah, they know where they meet. And so citizens have left the political space to be determined by all kinds of interests other than themselves. But that's for even countries where institutions have been built over time. It's worse for countries in Africa where there are no strong institutions for citizens to abandon governance to the few who make the decisions that affect them every day of their lives. So because we know that three things are important to interplay in the process of delivering governance of the kind that would accelerate not just the pace of economic growth, but would actually translate economic growth to structural change that boosts the diversity and the sources of growth, and therefore more inclusive and broader, and therefore much more beneficial to a larger number. Sound policies, strong institutions, effective and efficient investment. None of these three can ever happen in this next phase of Africa's development journey without the absolute participation of the citizens of each of the countries in Africa. There's no external force that will make it happen. Institutions are built by citizens. Agencies are created by government, but agencies are not institutions. Agencies are mere bodies. It is not until citizens take ownership of agencies and constantly make demands on agencies that they begin to transform into institutions. And yet, for many of the citizens on the continent, they couldn't care less about the agencies. They actually are of the belief that someday some Messiah is going to just come and make everything happen well in the countries. What they fail to understand is that there must be an incentive or a disincentive that would propel those who govern to make the right sets of choices that would help transform mere agencies into institutions. That's why the second part of my speech is about what will happen when the citizens arise. When the citizens of Africa arise, they would understand that today's economic growth and development is bolstered by productivity. Productivity is a function of basic good governance. There is a huge correlation between good governance and productivity. Societies where the basic rules of good governance are respected tend to be on the higher league in the productivity index or indices of the world. To the extent that the good governance score of Africa is still below 5 out of 10, shows that we have a journey yet ahead of us. Are the African citizens here? Okay, it's time to arise. Ladies and gentlemen, It has been found that the quality of policies, institutions, and investments that will position countries for the kind of structural change that Africa needs during this next phase of its growth can only be determined by the quality of its political context. Those countries where citizens quickly understand this and arise to their role in the democratic process will be the ones that will adapt their incentives appropriately to elicit the right responses from both the people, the governments, as well as the private sectors in their countries. The supply of governance has to be matched deliberately by a demand for good governance. Did you get that? Today, citizens stand on the sidelines of governance, not understanding that demand for transparency, for accountability, for probity, and a demand for sanction of corruption and every bad behavior, and a demand for the application of the rule of law as against the rule of man in the governance of the affairs of the nation state constitute the most important roles of citizenship. In my note, I said, it wouldn't make a big difference if the citizens of Britain, of the United Kingdom, decided not to bother about their parliament. It would take quite a long time before they can wreck and ruin the institutions that have been built over the years. When people snide in their remarks toward the politicians in Washington, they do it because they say, whatever they do there doesn't matter to me. I'm in my local community in Denver. We can figure out how to do our thing. They are completely not impressed, and so they don't care. But in the case of Africa, we don't have a choice. Africa must fix its politics. It has run its course, and a new normal must be reached. When we look at the quality of Africa's politics, it has undermined the quality of Africa's governance. Africa's politics has made significant improvements by virtue of the fact that it has gone from being a country riddled with all kinds of aberrant military rule or dictatorships into larger number of democracies on the continent. However, the quality of the players in the politics of Africa have only succeeded, the quality has only succeeded in delivering dismal governance outcomes. When the citizens of Africa arise and make a determination that a new quality of governance is important, they would do exactly what our dear friend Hillary Clinton said. They would understand that the most precious power of the citizen is the power to vote. And not just the power to vote, but the power to determine who is voted for. When we've taken a deconstruction of institution, which is one of the three important factors that interplay to deliver development outcomes, within institution is the whole construct of political leadership. And many times, we used to think that once you got the policies right, you were safe and dry. It has turned out to be that no matter how right you got the policies, the politics can ruin them in a matter of seconds. And so, ladies and gentlemen, imagine what would happen if African citizens no longer looked away from governance at even the lowest level of their politics. If citizens took an interest in what happened at the local authority level, if citizens took an interest in what happened at the state levels, if citizens took an interest at what happened at their national levels, citizens would create a counterbalancing force against a political elite class that has been sometimes too ravaging that I have imagined that I could find another word and not an elite class. Because the word elite in of itself conjures a memory of something much more good-intentioned than some of what we've seen in the class of very parasitic political leadership that some of the countries on the continent have contended with for several decades of existence. The only thing that changes it is going to be citizens coalescing and simply saying, no longer shall the worst amongst us govern the best amongst us. Imagine what would happen if amongst the citizens of the various countries on the continent, the youths would arise. Africa is a young continent. 70% of Africa's people are young. And if the citizens arose and demanded a new normal, a new social contract that would place education at the center of economic development strategy, just empowering the youths with quality and relevant education and the skills to compete for employability with their peers from the rest of the world, would add at least two more digits to Africa's economic growth. Imagine what would happen if the women arose. Today, Africa's women are 50% of Africa's population, and yet they constitute less than 40% of Africa's workforce. If the women arose and achieved the productivity and the participation that is important for all of the citizens of a country, it would add some two digits to Africa's growth rate, to activate the base of women in entrepreneurship, in all spheres of the economy. Imagine what would happen if the diaspora in this room arose. If they arose and voted with their feet to head home tonight. They would become leaders in organizing the people at all levels of society in order to influence this demand for a new normal. They would become the new entrants into the political space with global standards that they have lived with in all parts of the world. They would take up positions in the public sector and with their competences, their capacities, and their character, they would replace the currently transactional public sector space into strategic policy space. Imagine what would happen if the citizens of Africa arose and demanded that human capital, not natural capital, would be the basis of bragging rights of each country. That would end the resource-induced conflicts that have poisoned the space for cohabitation of various ethnic groups toward a diversity that improves innovation, creativity, and productivity in other societies. Imagine what would happen if the citizens arose and decided that they would insist that the rule of law and not the rule of man would prevail in their community. Imagine the orderliness and the predictability of consequences that would ensure that those who conduct themselves badly would receive their just punishment. On the continent of Africa, they would not need to be taken all the way to London. Imagine if the citizens of Africa arose and demanded the evolution of a new social contract. A social contract that puts the weight of leadership exactly where it belongs, on those who offer themselves to lead the rest, who must not just lead by virtue of position, but would lead on the basis of the moral credentials that enable societies to have some sets of values they are forever unwilling to negotiate. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that the citizens of Africa may have been waiting for too long for someone else to bail them out. And yet, the responsibility to bail themselves was long ignored. It's important that I remind you that Margaret Mead said something. She said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." The change that you have been waiting for the continent, is not going to happen by virtue of the political elite class on the continent of Africa suddenly waking up and deciding to have an epiphany. The change has to be forced on the political context of the continent. And the only ones who have the power to do so are the citizens. Some of you seated here tonight, I want you to know that you've had enough time in the UK. For how long are you going to leverage another society? Everything that must happen in order for there to be real Africa rising is dependent on the kind of choices that regular citizens like you and I would make concerning our continent. The continent is essentially waiting for you and all other citizens, wherever else they may be, to arise and to build. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Obi. Annual lecture, but also a rallying cry to Africa's citizens to arise. I've got the airport departure times for Ethiopian Airlines, Arik Air, and KQ Kenya, but stay till the end of this, and then you can. Thank you very much indeed. So we have about 15 or 20 minutes. For comments, actually, perhaps less time for questions because you kind of anticipated the questions and answered them in your lecture, Obi. So that was rather good. So we've slightly less time than we would have liked. Please introduce yourselves. Wait for the microphone. Microphone there. Is there a microphone? Another? Give it there. Could you give the microphone to there? Unless you'd like to ask a question. Introduce organisation if relevant.
Evening. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I am Eli Nikolaidis, and I am Greek, and I wanted to say that all Professor Obi, Dr. Obi said applies to my country too, not only to the African continent. And I think this is a global phenomenon that the citizens should arise, like you so well said, and take the power and their responsibilities in hand and put all our governors in the chair of being, you know what I mean by chair, to be accused and for them to bring back all they have embezzled, and then the world will have no problem.
Thank you.
Will all go to education, looking after the aged, to hospitals, to Ebola, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Take that as a comment.
Hello. Hello, Obi, I was listening to your lecture and I found...
Just say who you are.
Okay, my name is Pastor Ojimba Alex from Gospel Faith Ministries. I was listening to Dr. Obi and I found what you were saying very intriguing, but whilst you was talking, obviously, I was jotting down some notes as well because I was waiting for you to finish because I was going to like make my comments too. You said a lot of things about Africa, which I don't disagree with. I find it very interesting, but there's certain things I felt like on the African subject that you didn't touch.
Yeah, so, briefly, if you would. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I'll just speed up.
You're just looking down at your notes. You're getting me a bit worried. Yeah, go on.
Okay, I was thinking about, obviously, the topic is Africa on the rise, yeah, but I was thinking you didn't mention things like the tribal differences within Africa. You didn't mention the religious differences within Africa. You didn't mention the language differences within Africa. And these differences, they can become barriers, because within Africa, these things can lead to discrimination, and these things won't let the continent grow as a whole.
All right.
So that's one disadvantage. I've got one more thing I want to talk about. This is the most important. Let me just get to this one. This is the most important here. The second thing I wanted to talk about is, in terms of African growth here, we have to understand that it's not the political ways, it's not the political system that's going to change Africa and give it the growth. What's going to change Africa and give it its growth is the traditional ways. Because in the beginning, the Africans, we were the leaders of the world. One minute, we were the leaders of the world, and civilization itself started from Africa. So when civilization started from Africa, it's not
thank
the political
you.
Ways
thank
that
you.
Made Africa what it is.
Pastor,
it was the
thank
traditional
you.
Ways.
Thank you. Okay? Pastor, please, we've... End of sermon. Thank you, Pastor. Okay. Thank you. Please, we have time. Thank you. Good points raised. Yes, please. The lady here, you've got the microphone. I'm going to try and go gentleman, lady. Yeah, go.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much, Obi. That is very enthusiastic and very moving. My name is Kate Anolue, and I'm the former mayor of London Borough of Enfield, 2012-13. I'm really concerned with politics in Africa when it comes to women. And I've realized that where women are allowed to take part, it seems to improve a lot. For example, in Rwanda, where 64% of the legislatures are women, that has increased and has done very well. What is your idea, and how could we help other countries in Africa to realize the contribution from women, considering that we know that when you educate one woman, you educate the whole world. Thank you.
Now, I know you're all lovers of democracy. For the interest of democracy, please, can we have questions as short as possible? Yeah, so what was that, Obi? Oh, I didn't see my peripheral vision. Microphone, please, to Baroness Shirley Williams. No. Baroness, please, the Honourable Baroness here, please.
Well, Obi, first of all, let me say that whoever... taught you must be very proud of you. But the question I have to ask, I'll ask it very quickly. I spent some time in South Africa at the University of Southwest Africa, Western University, in the period immediately after Mandela came out of prison. He did many of the things you've called upon. He involved women, he involved local communities. As you know, community committees were actually unable to make decisions unless at least the one-third of women who were insisted should be there were part of the decision itself. What do you do to stop much of what you called for, as it actually happened in South Africa, reverting to a much more old-fashioned kind of crony politics? Mm.
Thank you. I'll take one more, then I'll give you a chance to answer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, okay, you've got the microphone. Briefly.
My name is Okechukwu Okorie, and I just want to just ask Dr. Obi a question, and that basically relates back to our country, Nigeria. And that's basically built on the concept of education, which you mentioned, and also going back to the campaign which you're part of, which we're proud of you, the Bring Back Our Girls campaign. Now, there is a school of thought that actually shares this criticism of the campaign, and that's that the campaign actually scratches just a surface of the challenge which led and which actually causes the increase in the Boko Haram current campaign in Nigeria. And just back from my experience, I was born in Lagos in the West. I spent just under 20 years in Maiduguri in Nigeria. And that region in the north has a challenge of education. Now, the Boko Haram insurgency is actually increasing because of we're having loads of young people not being educated. And the campaign you are currently spearheading, actually, if the girls come back, which we pray they would, it looks as if that will be the end. But the major challenge, the long-term challenge, is still there, which is the lack
thank
of education.
You. We'll take that as a comment, because you've asked the question and answered it. All right. Obi, briefly, and then I'm going to go 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. OK, I can get through all of you. if you are all brief. Obi, so first of all, this issue of tribalism and own traditions, how you can elevate the role of women, and Baroness Shirley Williams' concern about South Africa reverting to cronyism. Just a couple of sentences each one, please, yes, Obi. So thank you. I know you're a clever lady.
So, the barriers in, you know, created by differences, precisely what I said, that the diversity that is today converted, or rather manipulated into barriers, should actually be a source of strength for the continent. The reason that it is those barriers are exploited is part of the elite game. And that elite game is driven by the approach to development that we have so far taken. It's development based on natural resources.
Okay, all right, okay. All right.
Okay, so when they exploit those differences, then the differences become a barrier. In a basic cosmopolitan city, whether it's Nairobi or Lagos, people hardly even remember where, mm-hmm. what language they speak, okay. what religion they practice. But as soon as the elite manipulation happens, the divides come.
That's a very clear answer okay. to you there. Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Women in politics, you are so right, Kate. In Rwanda, a country that I know very well, we also found by virtue of research that where more women participate in politics, there is at least more than 50% possibility of better governance. So corruption is less in environments. This is now research. Corruption is proven to be less in societies where you have more women participating in politics. Now, how do you achieve that? I think that it starts from the very beginning of the education of the girl child. Being able to enable the girls in schools to understand leadership and how to express leadership at all times. Mm-hmm. That begins to give them a consciousness that they can be participants in the political process without compromising the many other realities of being a woman.
Thank you. And Baroness Williams, briefly.
And then the crony politics, at the bulwark of what helps to regulate cronyism is also the citizens acting concertedly. Because part of what we've seen is that if you defined the problems of crony politics, you would say that it would result in suboptimal development outcomes. Who then is the victim of suboptimal development outcomes? The people. And for as long as you can use economic research to show evidence that that outcome, that negative outcome, affects the citizen in the north as much as it affects the citizen in the south, mm-hmm. and the citizen in the west and the east, the citizens would act on the basis of action, group right. action for success.
Sure. Thank you.
And so that becomes an institutional way of regulating bad behavior okay. by politicians.
Thank you. I tell you, we're going to play it now because we haven't got a lot of time. Lots
Wait,
of hands.
Hands.
Yeah, yeah. We're not going to be able to. Could you keep your comments very brief? Microphone, ushers, if you give the microphones to people who you can see who've got their hands up straight away. I'm going to make this sound when it's your time's up and we're going to move on to the next person.
I promise
All right?
to make it two
yeah,
sentences.
And then I think we just ask you to incorporate
yes.
your closing statement with these points that have been put forward. So you're not going to get a very thorough Q&A. So comment, question.
All
okay.
right,
go
straight
ahead.
To the question. My name is Babatunde Rosso. I'm a PhD student, studying sociology. Dr. Obi, I want you to please talk about the comparison between development and governance as it relates to Africa and the West, Africa and China. So that's my question, and you know what I'm talking about.
All right, well, God, we'll be here all day answering that one.
Let me dismiss them quickly.
Okay.
All right, just very quickly.
Quick fire, rapid fire. Yeah, okay.
So the fact is that there is nothing fundamentally different between some of the ways that China is behaving and the way that the West behaved at a particular point in time. However, it would be totally silly on the part of Africa to repeat a pattern. And so Africa must develop the systems to support better outcomes.
Rapid headline questions, headline answer. You know I worked in news for a long time. Great. Headline question.
Good evening, Dr. Obi Kedu. Thank you so much for your comments this evening. Question very brief. As a young woman in the diaspora, working with Barclays Bank, your comments about coming home tonight, if I were to travel back to Nigeria tomorrow, what are some of the recommended actions, initiatives, concretely, that you'd say, okay, tomorrow come, this is where we need you?
Okay, quick answer. Next question.
I think you need to find your global partners, even already within the country. And, you know, it offers you a huge opportunity because there are different communities of expertise like yourselves that are already at home and can support the process of your transition.
Lots of banks in Nigeria. She can work in banking there. Right.
My question is very simple. How do you get people like me who sit at the high table with their knowledge that has passed by sale date and still take on leadership and don't want to vacate the seats for younger people? How do you boot us out and get younger people?
Right, you're volunteering.
Well,
right.
the young will boot you out.
Yeah, okay.
And it's to develop the consciousness on the part of the young that actions that are taken together provide better outcomes than individual initiatives.
Thank you.
Mohammed bin Madani, Maghrib Review. Two questions, if I may.
Huh.
One is
you
literacy.
Abuse my generosity as chair. Yeah. One, right. Please.
Okay. Literacy. You haven't given any figures on literacy, illiteracy in Africa, in your area. Uh-huh. So what's the exact number, if you know the numbers?
On illiteracy or literacy across the continent?
The literacy rate on the continent is now at least higher than 60%.
Okay, so who's 60%. Got the microphone? Yeah, you know, ownership is whatever it is. Gone. Yep. Next one there.
Hello. Good evening, ma'am. My name is Godwin. I'm a Nigerian and a youth advocate in the UK. I will confess that, you've done a lot of work with the Chibok girls in Nigeria. Where do you see yourself in the next political dispensation in Nigeria? I think we need you more.
All right. Are you offering to be her campaign manager? Sounds like you've got one there. Okay, one there. Quickly.
Well, I am not. I speak on the necessity for citizens to participate in the political process. But I am not a politician. I don't have the talent for politics.
Ooh, disagree. No, not true. They all beg to differ. Don't worry, guys, I'll talk to her later. Okay, next one.
My question...
Who's got the microphone?
I have the microphone here.
Okay, go ahead. Can we have a lady?
My question, you kept on talking about the diaspora coming home. I remember 10 years ago when you said the same thing with Nido, Nigerians in the diaspora. However, there is always this them and us attitude. So what did you learn about you moving away from the Western world to Nigeria and making an impact? What did you learn about the change? Because it is a very difficult thing when you want to make that transition. Well, I'm a Nigerian, to Nigeria.
Sure. So what I decided is that if the people who are resilient in wanting to do the wrong things are that resilient, since I would like to do the right thing, I would have to be more resilient.
Okay.
Yeah, my question is actually very similar to what that lady asked, because as a Nigerian, I've experienced that
Nigeria is actually quite defensive against other Nigerians coming from Western cultures because they don't like the views and values. And especially in Nigerian politics, it's very difficult to go into Nigerian politics if you don't start from the grassroots, such as like the cultural background. So how then can you recommend other Nigerian diasporas, Nigerians, to go back to try and participate in Nigerian leadership and governance when Nigerians themselves do not want that?
Yeah, well, it's easier for the young like him, though,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, because frankly speaking, what's the counterfactual? The counterfactual is that you're going to be sitting here speaking like a Briton, and
I can talk Nigerian as well.
And basically,
I just let you know.
Listen, we're grateful he's talking in English. Igbo's not
and
good.
Then, yeah. And then the best of the contribution you would make to the UK would not even show up on the map.
All right, great. Chap here, one sentence, please. Yeah.
Filmmaker Mick Charkey, much interest in Africa, African history, African future. Loved the lecture. Through it, questions kept coming back to me, or a certain phrase, stand up for Africa, stand up for African women, stand up for education, stand up for health. Yeah. The question is very simple. How ready is the citizenship of Africa to actually stand up for itself and fight
for it? It requires formidable mindset change, right? Because for so many decades, we were in military rule and all kinds of despotic governance, which did not, in of themselves, tolerate accountability. And so citizens have never been used to the idea of demanding accountability from authority. So it requires this kind of discourse to get people to understand that when citizens act together, there is no force that can act against them.
Okay. Dr. Khalid Mubarak, Sudanese Embassy. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Obi. My question is about the international context, the large context. How can Africa achieve what you dream for and what we agree with you about if the international financial system is loaded against Africa in a manner in which makes it very difficult for African countries to make the progress you talk about? Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Africa's economic growth and development can happen a lot through Africa's own economic integration. Today, trade between amongst African countries is just about 11%. Imagine what would happen if that trade got to the rates of about 35 in Latin America, or 45 in South Asia, or 80 in Europe.
Yeah. Good point. Okay. Now, what we'll do, Obi, is we'll just take these final ones and then just make your closing statement. Who's got the mic? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 8, 9. 30 seconds each, please. Because I've already well over time, you know. Go on.
Hello?
Yeah, it's working.
I just want you to... My name is Justin Kalfo. I'm a citizen of Burkina Faso. And in light of a recent event, I just wanted your view on what happened in Burkina. Is that what you predicted in your speech? Oh.
Thank you. We'll just take them all at the end. Burkina Faso, again.
If you were my follower on Twitter, you would have seen that when it was happening, I did say that what a shame that President Campaoré allowed that to happen, considering that it was averted just some 2 years or thereabout ago when it was going to happen.
Okay.
And we did warn him that don't make the mistake of trying your citizens again.
Keep up with
your
Twitter.
I am so proud of the people of Burkina Faso.
Good. Okay, thank you. Right, Obi, we'll just take these final points and then we won't do it one-on-one, otherwise there's no time. Okay, quickly, yes?
Okay, hi. My name is Tifesina Chiokafo. I'm a PhD student with the African Leadership Center at King's College. I'm also from Nigeria. You talked about how we should all come home and we shouldn't rely on outsiders, but our government doesn't seem to be doing anything in terms of investing in education. You find that it's outsiders that are actually funding all these people studying abroad. What solution would you rather suggest?
Okay, I think we're going to have to take these as comments. Yeah, give the microphone there, because people are already leaving now. We're way over time. People have got dinner. There's a microphone for a lady at the back. Just give that to the back, yes?
Yeah, I'm Sonny, and I think basically you've made a very good point about
citizens rising to kind of, you know, put pressure on government. But we know as well that government are very quick to use force, okay? So how do you deal with that? Do we need some sort of, you know, support from external, you know, sources?
You deal with that the same way that I dealt with it. I stood up to the force.
Okay.
Because there is something called the office of the citizen. And you must occupy your office of the citizen.
Okay. I think we're going to have to leave it there. I'm really sorry. We have run out of time, and I've been told that we have run out of time. We can't take any more. But so I thank you all for your contributions. And, of course, most of all, I thank Obi for her wonderful tour de force. And I think she's shown just what vision and energy that there exists on the continent. We can all harness it. We would all be much happier for it. I thank our sponsors, Diageo, for sponsoring these annual lectures at the Royal African Society. Thank you very much indeed, Diageo. We are very, very grateful to you for your support and sponsorship, and to our hosts here at the Royal Society of Medicine. And to all of you, please continue to be friends of the Royal African Society. We count on your support, and please spread the word and tell everybody just what we are up to. And we look forward to seeing you at our next annual lecture, if not before that, at our many activities between now and then. From me, Zain Abadar, it's been my privilege and my pleasure to chair this annual lecture, my very first. Thank you very much indeed, and good evening.